As most of you, or as many of you might know, Charlton Comics is a very interesting company. It had its beginnings in prison. The guys who started Charlton Publishing met while one of them was in prison for copyright infringement. They actually used to send you to prison. He published music magazines and didn't bother to get, deal with the copyright.
Like Parade, or they had music lyrics before the internet and everything.
Right. So he went to prison for that, and then there was another guy who was in prison. He was a Waterbury politician or lawyer who was in prison for some political scandal. They were both there for about a year. They met. They became friends. When they went out, they went into the publishing business together, publishing music magazines, this time copyrighted. Yeah. But they published magazines for years, and in the mid-40s, when the comic books were at their height of popularity, they started publishing them as well, mainly to keep their printing presses rolling. They owned their own printing presses. So they had to keep them moving to make money. So if comics were selling, they printed comics. And they printed comics for the next 40 years, including some characters that have become mainstays in the industry. You know, the Blue Beetle, The Question, Captain Adam.
Peacemaker, Nightshade.
Yeah, Peacemaker, right.
Son
of Vulcan, that's right.
Judo Master.
So it's a long and strange history, which hopefully we'll get into many aspects of it in the talk. They they stopped publishing comics in 1985. They went out entirely out of business in 92 or 4?
92, I think.
Yeah, 92. And what used to be the factory that contained everything from the printing presses to the production offices to a bowling alley to is now a strip mall in Derby, Connecticut. About a year and a half, 2 years ago, Mort Todd and me and Roger McKenzie, who you might remember from as being the writer on Daredevil when Frank Miller first started as the artist. He's also part of it. The three of us are kind of running the show. With the help of Dan Johnson, who writes Dennis the Menace. So he's a perfect fit.
And we've got an incredible array of artists and writers, an awful lot of the veteran Charlton creators who were there originally, and just a wide potpourri of genres and characters and art styles, and that I think embodies what Charlton did. They were willing to try anything back in the day, and if there was a trend, they'd capitalize on the trend, but they're also innovative in their way.
Yeah. Well, of all of us here, Roy has the earliest experience with Charlton. He was a school teacher
in St. Louis.
And was a very well known comic fan. One of the well known guys. Him and Jerry Bales were doing the earliest fanzines in comics in those days. And you tell your story.
Okay. I have a question about Charlton. I guess, was one of the first things they were doing, like the thing I swiped the name from, Yellow Jacket?
Yeah.
That was one of theirs. I used to read Yellow Jacket, and I thought that was a good name for a comic book character.
And the movie.
Right? Yes. That was the name Yellow Jacket was that, the different character, but I like that name.
And one of the best costumes ever.
Oh. Yeah, the black and yellow striped cape.
And I always thought of them for years as CDC because they had the symbol. I didn't, before it was Charlton, when they were doing magazines like and everything back in the 50s, it was CDC, that was their distribution symbol, and capital distribution and so forth. And I was buying the comics when they started came out with a few superheroes. They started Blue Beetle and Son of Vulcan and a couple of and so forth. Those two actually.
Right.
Both of them done by the team of
Talarico
and Fracchio and so forth. And
was it Joe Gill probably writing it?
Probably Joe Gill writing him. And I bought those. I mean, I thought the art was a little crude and so forth, but I liked the concepts. I actually like that version of Blue Beetle better than the later stuff that Ditko in the past seasons. As a concept. And especially when Gil Kane did it once. And I like Son of Vulcan, who was obviously an imitation Thor. It wasn't a bad idea. And then one day as I was editing Alter Ego, just kind of getting started and doing one or two issues back in 64 or 65, I got a a letter that was sent out to a number of comic book fanzine people. I may have exchanged a letter with him before, from Pat Mazzulli, M-A-S-U-L, is double L? Yeah, and I never met him, never seen a picture of him. I've been trying to find a picture for years. But he was sort of the editor-in-chief, and he drew a little. He had drawn the Tarzan picture, too, for that, for that unauthorized Tarzan. And he said that they were looking to get some new blood in Charlton, and he wanted to send out kind of a thing to ask the readers of the comics fanzines, could you publicize that we'd accept things, scripts on Son of Vulcan, Blue Beetle, and it may have been something else that started, but at that time there were just those two that I remembered. Captain Atom, I don't think it started, maybe it had started, I don't know. But anyway, so now the Alter Ego only came out, you know, was going to come out once or twice a year and so forth. When I get it together, it wasn't exactly a news magazine. Besides, why should I help the competition? So I never did say a damn word anywhere about the thing. I didn't tell anybody. If they want to find out from one of the other editors, that's just fine. I was in the business of, you know, publicizing myself. So what I sat down was, I just sat down that weekend and wrote a story myself about Son of Vulcan, which I liked as a character. I thought, well, that's more obscure. Maybe, you know, nobody else will do it. For all I knew, comic book fanzine editors and writers all over the country were doing it, but apparently not right away. And I sent it in. And I got a letter saying that, you know, he accepted it. I thought, boy, that was really nice. My fortune is made, you know. I was a teacher, and I wasn't making a lot of money, so I thought, and it turns out the rate was like $4 a page, which even in 1960, early 65, was not a tremendous amount of money. On the other hand, the money I made that weekend, the $80, $90, whatever it was, you know, for doing it, was as much as probably as I made teaching that week, so it wasn't a bad deal for spending a day or so doing something I actually liked. And so I did one, and I sent in, they said, would you like to try maybe a Blue Beetle? So the next weekend, or a weekend or two later, I did a Blue Beetle, and, you know, they bought that one. And around that time, I think it was a little after, I was asked to become the assistant editor of the Superman books, and so I didn't get around to doing too much, you know, more in that next couple of months, and went there. And once I got to D.C., Mort Weiser, first thing he told me was, no, when I told him about the Charlton thing, he says, you can't write for that little company if you're working here, you know. It was on staff, it made sense. And so, but at that time I was staying with Dave Kaler, uh-huh, who was a prominent fan and did a couple of the earliest conventions. So I sort of segued over, he wanted to write, so I tried to help him out. Tom Fagan was also submitted a script at that time. They bought some, but unfortunately, my issues of Son of Vulcan and my issue of Blue Beetle became the last issue. I'm sort of like, you know, I closed out those two magazines and everything, you know, and it wasn't intended. But what always got me was the fact that the whole thing, they said on the cover of Son of Vulcan, it says, fanzine readers, like there was, how many were there? A few hundred, a couple of thousand in the whole country.
Yes.
Fanzine readers, Charlton's challenge has been answered. Not that anybody knew about this challenge. I hadn't told anybody, and I don't know if, I never saw much of anything. It said, this issue has been written by one of you. Okay, so I open up the name, I powerful see my name on the page with Fracchio and whatever, Sacco and Benzetti, whoever it was. And it says, and there it is, script by R. Thomas. I mean, I got nine letters in my name, and they can't manage to spell it out. And it was very crude, but you know, it was a big thrill to. I did the footnote of that thing is a few months later when it came out. By that time, one or two of my Millie stories had come out from Marvel already. When it came out, and I said, I showed Stan, Son of Vulcan, came out. Says, you're lucky I hired you before I saw this. He didn't really read it. I think he was probably reacting to pictures, but I probably was lucky, you know. But anyway, that was my. I was really thrilled to work for Charlton.
Career first going from Charlton to DC to Marvel within a couple of
and
weeks.
And then later, just a few months later, I plotted a story anonymously for him. By that time, Dick Giordano had come in, and I'd met him and sent Gary Friedrich up to him to pretty soon to be a writer, and I. I made up this character for one of their comics, the Shape, right, who was sort of an alien plastic man, but I couldn't put my name on it. I gave it to my fandom friend Grass Green to draw, and Grass kind of was fooling around with the writing, so I said, you go ahead and write it. I can't have my name on it anyway. So Grass did that, and that was kind of nice. So it was, later on, Gary Friedrich started doing that Superman with S-O-U-P-E-R-Man strip, and he put the Bestest League of America, with my permission, and Bad Man and Robber as characters in there that I had made up. But I, so I was in Charlton, I just never was allowed, never was able to have my name on it after that. Yeah, anyway, that's it.
Whirlwind career.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you know, it's weird, you know, a lot of people stay to Charlton, a lot of people could never go beyond Charlton. But, you know, guys like Steve Ditko, who could go anywhere he wanted, he stayed at Charlton because they sent him a script and left him, or let him write his own stuff, and left him alone. You know, he could do whatever he wanted. He could draw however he wanted. There was, you know, and their laissez-faire attitude wasn't because, you know, they knew that you get the best out of creative people if you leave them alone. It's because they just didn't care. It was, you know, they were running, again, they're running their printing presses, presses which were originally made to print cereal boxes and were adapted to print comic books. So it didn't matter what they put out. They were largely followers. They were.
But Dick cared.
Dick cared. Dick, yeah. Well, Dick always cared, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Dick Giordano, their doctor.
Yeah, when Dick came in 1965, 66, he brought back the superheroes. He was, well, the action heroes. He didn't like superheroes. Yeah. He wanted, you know, he liked non-powered guys. And there is a lot to be said for that. It's a lot more challenging to write, and it forces you to deal with, yeah. You write a Superman story, whatever happens, like, Superman, I thought you were dead. It's like, well, I was, but I got better, you know. So the real life characters are more interesting to deal with. But Dick brought back, you know, Captain Atom and Blue Beetle, and then it led to the creation of the rest of these characters, you know, Peacemaker and
Sarge
Steel. And, you know, he was giving these creators their heads. Yeah, you know, Pat Boyette, go ahead, create a superhero. He comes in with Peacemaker, the man who loves peace so much he's willing to fight for it, you know. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a great strip. I wrote a version of it later at DC in the 80s, and I amped it up a little. He loved peace so much he was willing to kill for it, but it was the 80s. You know, but they're great characters. And Dick tried those for, I don't think it lasted a year. And that just went right down the tubes.
But it's a real high watermark.
Yeah, well, you know, some Steve Ditko stuff that will, and Jim Aparo was another artist who started there. Let's talk about people who started there, you know.
Don Steve, Newton.
Don Newton, yeah. Steve Skates, Roy Thomas, Paul Kupperberg.
Yeah.
John Byrne.
Yeah, John Byrne, Joe Staton, Bob Layton, Mike Zeck. Yeah, it was really just, you know, because it was such a cheesy little company, you know, newbies would go, well, I can sell to them. Maybe Gold Key won't buy from me, but Charlton will, and son of a gun.
Although, my first work for them was free.
Yeah.
I literally was 15 years old, and they had a title called Charlton Bullseye. And the whole idea was some guys, at this point, Charlton had just been doing reprints. So they basically, some guys came up and said, hey, we want to do some new stuff. This guy by the name of Dan Reed. John Beatty, I think, inked his work on that. So they went up to Charlton. They brought this stuff up, and they basically offered it for free with the idea that they'll get exposure, and Charlton will have material that's not reprints. So they did that, and it went over well, and they said, well, let's see if anyone else out there wants to give us work, and we'll pay you in copies. And I was 15 years old, and it was like, okay, I'll try it. Why not? I did a one-page story. I called them up, and at first, not really understanding how the comic book world worked at that particular point, I'm thinking, well, I'm going to show them my work, and they'll offer me a script. And that wasn't really what they were looking for or how they were going to go about publishing it. So some friends of mine had gone up like a week earlier, and they did exactly the same thing. That was the mindset. So they, you know, they had their work looked at, and the editor said, it looks good, but, you know, we don't have anything for you. You know, do you have a completed story? And they didn't, so they kind of got sent packing. And so having heard that, I literally wrote and drew a story and was inking it on the train to go to Charlton. And they went through this whole thing. They looked at my work and said, oh, this is good work, but, you know, we need, you know, something that's completed. Do you have anything completed? I said, well, I got this one page here. And they looked at it and said, this is it. We like this. We'll go with this. So my first work was at the age of 15. I turned 16 by the time it published. But that was my first work. It was at Charlton.
Was it for a horror book or Bullseye?
It was for Bullseye. It's a one-page story about a guy who's the size of an ant and is like lice in somebody's hair. It's Charlton Bullseye number 4.
So. Well, my first exposure was it was in the mid 70s. I'd been doing fanzines with Paul Levitz through high school and we gave up. We were doing the Comic Reader, which I believe you're vaguely familiar with at that time, and we graduated high school and going into college, so we gave it up, passed it along to other people to do. And Paul had already started working at DC as Joe Orlando's assistant editor, and I had been trying to break in as a writer. I'd done some like ghost writing for friends who had already broken in, but my first try was at Gold Key, and I got rejected. Wally Green. A lovely man. He actually had me come in, sat me down, told me why he wasn't accepting any of the stories, and I walked out of there happy. I've never been rejected and left feeling happy. You know, like, he's such a nice man. But then I sent those same stories to Charlton, and a few weeks later I got a letter from Nick Cuddy saying, yeah, we like this one, we'll buy it. Write up this other plot idea or whatever. And there I was writing for comic books. And I did about half a dozen stories, and then I started selling to DC. And
you came in right after Mickey Rudy and Judy Garland.
That's right, that's right. That was pretty much it, yeah. And, I started writing for DC, and I regret now that I didn't continue writing for Charlton. Yeah, there was no reason why, except for Charlton was paying me $5 a page, and DC was paying me $15 a page.
That's a good reason,
but ideas are easy.
Yeah.
I could have written more for them, but.
And Paul's first story was a barbarian tale with a twist he just recently republished a sequel to it. After
that's right.
39 years.
40 years, yeah. Mike Zeck drew the story originally. He was a newbie at Charlton as well in those days, and then 40 years later, I came up with an idea for a sequel to that story.
And Neil Vokes
did a beautiful job on it. Yeah.
Neil D. Vokes.
Neil.
So Keith, right, how did you first get interested in wanting to do a movie, a documentary about this fable?
Well, Mort, that's an interesting question. It was a calendar year ago, actually, tomorrow. We went to a panel at the Connecticut ComiCONN in Bridgeport. I saw names on the Jumbotron that I'd recognize, Denny O'Neill, Bob Layton, Paul. And I said, my feet were killing me, and Jackie too. And I said, let's go into that, you know. And I thought I was going to hear about Batman, Iron Man, and all kinds of cool stuff. And they said, we're going to talk about this company, Charlton Comics. And I went, oh. What's that?
And then obviously they agree.
And I slowly started to remember them being on the spinner rack as a kid. Never really bought too many of them. But the stories that came out that started to unfold in that panel forced me to move closer. And then the next day when I was recapping it in my brain, I went, oh my God, how did I not see this yesterday? There's a movie in this. This story needs to be told. So we raced back down to the Comic-Con, introduced ourselves to Denny, Bob and Paul, and pitch the idea, and here we are a year later with a trailer to show. So,
yeah, you guys have seen the world premiere of the team. Yeah.
it's been a really interesting ride, and so far, I think, and I can speak for Jackie on this, that our favorite part of it has been making all these great new friends. The people who worked around Charlton and went on to DC and Marvel and that we've been in contact with interviewing for this thing are just stellar people. So we're just having a ball.
And me.
And Paul.
Okay. Yeah, the history of the company has some mythic qualities to it. It survived.
You couldn't write this stuff.
Gangster origins.
You really couldn't.
It survived the Great Derby, Connecticut flood of the 50s, where all the presses were underwater and all the magazines pulped. And it came back, and just the whole, the facilities where it started, run into the building, you start doing the magazines, you bring them.
But on the other hand, after the flood and they cut the rates to all the artists and writers after the flood because, right. You know, they had to
recover. They already cut rates.
And they were already covered by insurance. So, you know, you've got the yin and the yang of Charlton Comics. It's
it's a better story than Eddie and the Cruisers.
Yeah, I went to an estate sale at John Santangelo's old house. He was one of the original owners of Charlton. And I went to that. I went with John. I took John Byrne as well because, you know, I thought also being a Charlton, started at Charlton, he'd want to. So we went and, you know, there wasn't much there Charlton related, really. The best thing was the plaque from the front of the building, the brass plaque. Said Charlton Publications was up for sale, but somebody beat us to it. There was a guy who had actually worked for Charlton, so he was like, okay, yeah, I can.
He bought a plaque that said
a couple of
he said boxes. It said the brass plaque that was in front of the that
yeah,
said Charlton.
It just said Charlton Publishing.
Yeah. Yeah.
No,
yeah.
Charlton. It didn't say Charlton's up for sale.
No.
Maybe somebody bought on sale
side. I think a lot of people thought that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, tell them what you scored out of it, Paul.
I scored a Charlton box. A packing box, you know, just a regular size, whatever
cardboard.
It is. Right, cardboard with you know, paper tape holding it together, and with the Charlton logo printed in red on the side.
And after you guys left, Mitch, who runs the show here, Mitch and I ended up going into places they marked "Don't Enter," and we ended up finding two more of those boxes. So.
And other people have to settle for Al Williamson art, you know.
And they're also marked with the CDC, which now means Center for Disease Control.
Yes. Well, in its own way,
how appropriate, right?
In its own way, it did then too. It was there was some of the, the company kept going for, you know, they kept pushing. I mean, they were the last company to do romance comics. You know, everybody had been out of romance comics by what, 76, 77? Yeah. And Charlton was still doing them. I think they still had half a dozen titles in the, about 83.
Yeah, they kept plugging. They would go out of business in the 80s a couple months of on and off. And like I say, with the romance, they tried to be topical. The last title was like soap opera romance.
Yeah.
Hey, everyone likes soap operas.
That's right. And it was usually like, you know, different 92 less variations of, you know, AB's Irish Rose. It was like, he's Jewish, she's not. What? Yeah, right.
It might have also been some of the first American publishers to bring in South American.
That's true. That's true.
Totally for financial reasons.
Well, yeah.
Even the Asian, artists, too.
Yeah.
The Filipinos and the Asian.
Yeah, San Joaquin.
Jose Luis Garcia Lopez, who is probably one of the greatest talents to ever work in the comic industry. Is from Argentina, and he started drawing romance stories for Charlton.
Beautiful.
Except he worked through an agent. He had no idea who he was working for. He would draw stories, send them in. I asked him about covers. He said he never drew a cover. They would just take a panel from the inside and blow it up and use it.
Splash
or something. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so we had him on the panel. I was like, so, Jose, what was it like to work for Charlton? He goes, I don't know. But I still had him on the panel. That's what I wanted.
Yeah.
You know?
And even like their romance comics were unique in that they had continuing characters. At times. They were like
My friend Gary Friedrich made up from one of those, Tiffany Sin.
Oh yeah, she was.
That
like
was a romance, sort of a spy.
Crossover. It started in the romance book. My personal career, or it was like women's.
Yeah. That's when we were living in Greenwich Village together at Doctor Strange's place. Yeah.
And then it went into the Sarge Steele and secret. Yeah.
Oh, I forgot to talk about the last story I wrote for. Actually, I did write for Charlton. Back when Gary was on his was had just married his second of the five wives he had, second one, and he was honeymooning. I don't know, somewhere in a hotel in Manhattan. But he asked me. He says, "I got to deliver a romance story." He says, "Can you write one?" I said, "Well, I don't know. I could ghost one. You know, I could try." But it was supposed to be an eight pager. So I started writing it. And I came up with the title and the general theme. It was called "If You Love Me, Fight for Me." And you know the story as soon as I hear it. You know, some girl that, you know, her boyfriend, you know, won't stand up for or whatever. And I wrote the first four pages, and I don't often get a writer's block about writing comic, but I just got so disgusted, you know, at writing the story. I got to page four, and finally when Gary came back, he says, listen, you got these four pages, you know, but I said, I just can't get onto it. You know, the guy's gotten beat up because he won't fight, and his girls left him because he's disgusted. So Gary said, oh, well, I'll finish it off. So he got out, and next panel, the guy starts taking karate lessons, you know, and he goes and he's ready to beat up the other guy, but I guess he didn't at the end. So that was our collaborator. That was my final straw for.
Yeah, well, I was going to say, it was like the sand kicked in anybody's face.
I also helped Gary make up a group that ran for several issues. Denny wrote the last couple stories, The Sentinels.
Right.
Oh, yeah. Sam would have killed me if he'd known I came Ranger. Up. I think I actually gave him the name The Sentinels before I remembered where it came from.
Yeah.
Gary, it was a three-person group, sort of like an X-Men-ish kind of group, and it was drawn by Sam Granger, who I recommended because he had been drawing a cover or two for and drawings for Alter Ego, and he was a professional commercial artist in North Carolina, and he ended up, of course, then he came over later on. I got him into doing inking for Marvel.
Well, what was
so you know,
about the Sentinels was, as superheroes, they wore no masks, but in their secret identities, they were beatnik Greenwich Village singers who wore masks.
Was that true? I don't remember that. I never read this stuff.
Right.
I just, you know.
Yeah, because we did a parody, because I was thinking that DC might own them, because it was in a Sarge Steel magazine, so they might own that universe.
They don't, though, huh? They don't think they. You don't know. You don't
also
know.
Also vague.
Yeah, yeah.
So instead, I did the barely sentient.
But Gary made up a lot of great. Gary made up a lot of great titles. I don't remember the stories, but the stories I remember. I never read them, but he would just make up a title to a story. I remember there was one like there was a song on the radio, "Please Don't Play A11." So Gary made up a story. I don't know how he dreamt it up. "Please don't play B11." You know? And another one, we were singing about, I don't know, down in the boonies or something, because, you know, we both came from a little town in Missouri. So he would just make up these outrageous stories, and Dick just loved them. Gary just be sitting there typing. He probably made as much money writing as me, because I was a much slower writer.
Right,
he would just sit down there, and nothing would stop it.
You would
type away.
Well, you had quality over quantity.
Well, he wrote okay. He wrote good.
Yeah, well, you know, there were
I keep
guys
forgetting how many connections I had to try.
Yeah, no,
more than any human being should actually have had.
You know, there was guys. You know, the most legendary is Tom Gill, Joe Gill. Tom was his brother, but Joe Gill was the writer, and he is it Newman or him who's in the Guinness?
Paulus Newman, yeah, I think Newman
beats him.
But
so,
yeah,
but
Joe,
Paulus Newman, who wrote primarily for like Gold Key and stuff, is probably holds the world's record for most pages. But Joe Gill would—he just typed.
Filled up books.
He just filled up books. He would write 100 pages a week, I hear. Mm-hmm. And again, $5 a page. You know, if he had done that.
Well,
he was
on staff a lot too, wasn't he?
Oh, that's
where
true. He probably was on staff.
Nine to five, and then drink from five to ten.
But still, 100. But yes. Yeah. Yeah. No, there were the stories too about the, you know, the scotch bottles in the desk drawers there too. Yeah.
That was not unique to Charlton.
Yeah.
I'll attest to that. It cracked.
That would would explain Mort, huh? Nothing explains Mort.
Yeah.
But you know, he would just, you know, I mean, I'm not that fast a writer, but you know, but I can turn out a story. But he could sit down and write, you know, a 6-page story. In like Kaniger, you know,
yeah.
Quicker than you could
read
it.
Yeah, like in a lunch hour, he'd sit down in the lunch hour.
Why did that? You know, was it just that Dick didn't feel when he went to DC that he would ever be able to make the transition to doing what they wanted? Because I read some of his stories, and some of them seem quite capable. And I can't believe he can't have done as well as some writers that worked for DC.
Some of them I have read. They are, I don't know what the hell's going on. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, I was like, he was just again. He was probably like. The wind blew the pages on the floor, and he got some wrong pages mixed in, I think, because it doesn't quite. But, you know, but other stuff, I was perfectly competent. He did do a few jobs for DC. I think he wrote an issue or two of Hot Wheels. that Toth was doing back in the day.
Yeah, it almost seems like there was some stuff in the late
60s. Yeah, he did some horror stuff and some Hot Wheels, but I guess he really didn't cut the mustard there.
What happened to him eventually?
I never
met him.
Yeah, I don't know anything about him.
Well, he was there till the end of Charlton. I got some calls from him because he and Ditko were still talking.
Yeah.
Like in the mid-80s, there was the Ace Comics, which were reprinting, and Joe worked with Steve on an update of the Face, the character of the Face. And so, you know, he was still trying to be active. I think he was writing articles and probably working on novels and stuff towards the end.
I think he did a book with Frank McLaughlin, the Big Edsel Band or something like that.
Oh, yeah. That too, yeah. Yeah, that's just it. Ace used them a lot in the mid-80s, but they didn't last too long either. But yeah, prolific.
Yeah, it's amazing. I mean, there's, you know, a few guys like that. There's Bob Kaniger was another one who could just sit down and hit the keys, and you know, before you think he could have done the first page, he's got a story. But it also explained weird things like the first Metal Men story, or an issue of the Metal. I don't know if it was the first one, but you know, like they beat the villain by page 17. Now he's got 8 pages to go. So suddenly dinosaurs burst through the floor. It's like, go for it! Yeah. But, yeah.
As Wally Wood once wrote, I haven't seen a good dinosaur stampede in ages.
That's right. No. Put it in there.
Yeah, and that also Charlton, too, speaking of Wally Wood, they got a lot of art like Kirby and stuff from companies that went out of business from the 50s to the 70s that they would absorb the inventory.
Who was the editor Charlton didn't like Wally Wood and kept complaining to the people that would bring Wally in as if he got you guys hypnotized or something? There was somebody, because he had guys like, Sherman?
Yeah.
There was a guy, Sherman, who was a Wally Wood assistant who worked for him. So forth. It seemed like there was I heard about some Charlton editor who, when they tried to bring Wally up there, might have been. I don't know. It might have been George Wildman. I never
Bill Pearson,
knew him.
I know, was also.
Oh, Bill Pearson. Yeah, I knew him.
Bill Wood. I mean, he was part of Walter Ego.
Witsend. He took over after Woody died. Yeah. He took the rights to Witsend.
But, and Nick Goody would do Woody type stuff. There was a lot of wood like art.
I think Nick was also one of his assistants.
Yeah.
It's hard. You're hard pressed to find somebody in the 60s and 70s.
Not Howard Sherman. Wayne Howard.
Wayne Howard. That's who I was thinking. I said Sherman. I got the names mixed up. I meant Wayne Howard. Yeah.
Wayne Howard did a fantastic wood.
Yeah. Midnight Tales, some of his stuff. It was some really nice stuff there.
Yeah, he created those characters. Yeah.
Yeah.
They got better art and writing than I don't mean my story, but they got better art and writing than they deserved or paid for, or noticed. But Dick was an exception there, and I don't know about the other, but Dick, you know, really cared about it, and he just got lucky that just about time that his stuff that he liked was all dying, Ditko, instead of him bringing Ditko to D.C., as everybody thinks, it was actually Ditko who got them to hire Dick, you know, yeah.
But you're saying, they're just, Charlton had some, just about any artist you can think of.
We couldn't believe it up at Marvel. I mean, Ditko walks in one day. I was sitting there, you know, been working just a few months. Ditko walks in, and when he leaves, after dropping off a story, because he and Stan, of course, didn't speak, so they never even managed to encounter each other in the office somehow by some sort of a radar. And as soon as he leaves, and Saul's told Stan, Saul's told me, Ditko walked in and he's quit. He says he's finishing this Spider-Man and this Doctor Strange, and then that's it for him. And I thought, what is he going to do? And I figured he'd show up at DC right away. Not right away, though. No, what he did, he was just happy working for Charlton for a third or so of the rate. The day he quit, there was a memo about a raise for him on the on Saul's office. So it wasn't about money, but it was just because he didn't feel comfortable, even though he had full plotting credit. I don't know, you know, how they divided the money up. Stan probably got a little of it yet. But still, Ditko, you know, was doing okay out of it. And all of a sudden, I could have seen him going to D.C. directly. Right. But he went to Charlton. I mean, that was wrong way.
He went back to Charlton.
Because he was already working there. He was content then to work totally for Charlton. Right. You know, he never stopped.
I guess after, you know, 3 years of Stan, he was looking for somebody who was... I've got nothing against Stan. I think Stan is, you know, the man, let's face it. But you know, after 3 years of being under that kind of editorial, thing, to go to Charlton where nobody is even like, well, you know, here's the page of Shaw, here's your check, you know. It had to be to him, like, you know.
Sure, there's a lot of creative freedom, and I think it shows in some of the, you know, detail and effort he put into the Blue Beetle and Question stories.
Even
awful lot of foreshadowing that wasn't allowed to develop and everything,
And you know, these guys were given, you know, in the mid-70s, the artists were given a lot of leeway. You know, they'd be handed a Tom Gill, a Joe Gill script, and can I change it? Yeah, do whatever you want to it. Well, Byrne would get, you know, John Byrne was doing Doomsday Plus One, and, you know, he's drawing the scripts, and they're, you know, Joe Gill, goofy science fiction comic book scripts. And John finally talks to the editor and says, can I, and he thinks, yeah, sure, go ahead. And he called up Joe and said, Joe, do you mind if I change it? And Joe says, I don't care. You know, Joe's feeling was he's been paid.
Yeah, once it turned around,
yeah. So, you know, so you try to do that at DC or Marvel.
Right.
For, oh, I mean, artists have tried it. But but they don't get that response.
No, it was, I, one of the earlier writers, and it might have been Joe Gill, but I can't remember specifically right now. And I discussed a particular story based on the character that he had written, and I wanted to make some changes. And I said, you know, is this okay? And he said, do what you want. Yeah. We, you know, there's no prima donnas here.
Yeah.
And I'm like, okay.
Yeah. Well, that was, you know, that a lot of these guys were, you know, I use the term old pro without derision. You know, you came in, you picked up the job. My one time meeting Steve Ditko, I was editing at DC. I was working on the New Gods title, and I was commissioning a bunch of backups. And I offered one to Steve, and he said sure. He came in, picked up the script, and I'm so excited. You know, Ditko had drawn a few stories of mine over the years. One of my first Charlton stories, and then one or two Legion things at DC. Steve Ditko on Legion of Superheroes.
Yeah.
I mean, how much more mismatched?
I wrote one of those.
Did,
yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. But how much more mismatched was that, you know? But anyway, and he comes in and, you know, he's very professional, talks about the job, looks at the script. Any questions? No, it's a 6-page backup. Steve Ditko doesn't have any questions. You know, and when I try to engage him a little on, you know, my fanish enthusiasm in history, he's like very nice, thank you. Now about the voucher, should I sign? Mm-hmm. You know, he doesn't want to talk about that stuff.
See,
but
I've got a completely different experience.
Really?
Oh yeah, because he'd come into my office for years and spend hours.
Wow.
And we'd talk the whole gamut from movies and, yeah, you know, books and even politics and comics, and he sure
then it was
enjoyed
just me.
His comics, you know?
Yeah.
He was definitely one of the first, you know, the first generation of fans,
yeah,
in the 40s that got into the industry.
Oh, sure.
And
he was just about the first pro to go to a comics fanzine.
Exactly.
He was one of the only pros, yeah, along with the other
Julia.
Gil. The other Gil, Tom Gil.
Gil. Tom Gil. Yeah.
Of the only two real pros, there was some intern from Marvel, but
yeah,
they were the first two pros at the 1964
wow.
Comics convention. His first and last convention.
Yeah.
He's never
yeah.
been to a convention since 1964.
He won't. Yeah, he's been invited. Will not go.
Yeah. But he's not as isolated as people think.
No, he's not a hermit. He just
yeah.
doesn't
and
see
he,
publicity.
He responds to people, just about everybody who writes to him and stuff.
And his address is in the phone book.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, people knock on his door and, you know, like say hi. And sometimes he'll be very nice. Sometimes he'll send them away. But, you know.
I just got a letter from him last week because I sent him a bunch of books. We're reprinting a lot of his work that he's given us approval and everything. And he's... Because a lot of times you just didn't know how he'd react to stuff, and he was very positive about it.
Good, yeah.
Yeah, and he likes the idea of us reviving Charlton. He's like, you know, thought our first issue was too much kind of parody of it, and I was like, well, it's developing.
Mm-hmm.
He likes the current issues.
Well, you know, moving to the new Charlton, the Charlton Neo, you know, it actually started out as a on a Facebook page. And we were talking, you know, a bunch of fans of the old Charlton stuff, and I joined the group. It was started by a guy named Fester Faceplant. I hear it's a Hungarian name. and I joined up, and, you know, a few other people who had been involved in Charlton, with Charlton, joined as well, and somebody made a crack about doing a fanzine, you know, with all the talent online. And I volunteered to write a story if it got off the ground, and it did. So the first issue really started out to be a fanzine. Just like, we were just gonna do a goofy, let's have fun fanzine. And my story was kind of my answer to Watchmen, because they use the Watchmen, the Charlton characters for Watchmen. So I kind of did my little ten pages, or 8 pages, whatever it was, response, which was, you know, no, you didn't have to go to the dark side. You know, these guys never were on the dark side. You didn't have to go there. But, and then there was some other stuff like that. And but once we realized we were going to be doing something, we quickly moved away from that. You know, we started developing new characters because, frankly, all the good characters, you know,
well,
are gone.
I mean, action heroes went to DC, right. But there are an awful lot of characters.
There are,
that,
but
that
you know,
brought back and developed and gone and some
Yellow
directions.
Bee. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
What?
There was
Yellow Bee.
I think originally Yellow Jacket was called Yellow Bee.
Oh, was he?
Yeah. Yeah. And everybody wants to do a. We are open to submissions from anybody. We don't accept everything, but we are open to submissions from everybody.
So they're not truly Charlton.
They are not truly Charlton. Well, yeah, that's right.
Well, if we had our own printer presses.
That's right.
Dang sure we'd be
right. And a bowling alley.
Yeah. Dick Giordano told, I'm sure he told it told me several times, so he must have told other people many times, the time he really knew that it wasn't a serious business was when he couldn't get through some of the hallways because there were all these plates, the metal plates they printed
printing.
The books on, you know, yeah. Printing plates, and he could barely get through, and he asked the owner, or whatever, you know, it's just, What is this? Well, we're waiting for the price for scrap metal to go up.
Yeah.
You know?
You know? Yeah.
And this is also the place that treated the original artwork. Back in those days, nobody thought there was any value to original artwork. You know, it's famously newspaper syndicates would throw the art down on the floor on rainy and snowy days to, so there would be, you know, Raymond Flash Gordon pages being used as doormats. And Charlton did the same thing. There was a spill, they would, you know, throw some art to soak up the
well,
wet.
As long as they had their stats to reprint, they had silver prints, and again, there was silver in that paper.
Yeah.
Which made it a lot more valuable than original art.
Yeah.
As long as you can reprint it, add the silver, everybody's
keep in mind
happy.
The roster of artists that went through there.
Yeah.
Just think of what's been lost.
Yeah. And there were guys over the years who made attempts to salvage some of the art and, you know, return it to their creators.
John Wren.
John Wren, who later worked at DC Comics in the production department, sent a lot of stuff back. But, you know, we're talking about a 40-year war, you know.
Well, one of the sad things to me was that flood, I didn't realize that flood wiped out all the Fawcett artwork they had bought.
Yeah. Oh.
And while they reprinted a few, we'd have had a lot more leftover stories and then maybe new stories of Nyoka and
right.
Ibis the Invincible and a lot of stuff. They might have eventually brought back Spy Smash, some
of
those.
Their own stuff.
Yeah.
They did, like, more
well,
stuff.
Yeah, but they had a lot of old stuff they could have
like
reprinted or printed for the
yeah.
first time, but then the flood.
Yeah.
You know, wipe that all away.
Unpublished Hoppy the Marvel Bunny story.
Yeah, which became
magic.
Happy the Magic
Happy
Bunny with the magic word Alazam, and he was in blue instead of red.
Right.
Yeah, they took off.
But I recognized him. I think most people.
Yeah, they would do like reprint some Wiz stuff, and they would accidentally.
Lance O'Casey.
Yeah. And the Golden Era. But they would sometimes have like quiz pages, like.
Oh yes.
And they would put a mustache on Captain Marvel.
Yeah, or goggles or something. Yeah, right, right.
But yeah, that was like we were saying, it was a good cheap way to have product, keep those presses going, and just buy up, you know, like when Simon and Kirby went, it was Headline, I guess, when they went out of business, mm-hmm. they continued.
So Bullseye, the last several issues of Bullseye were Charlton. That's some of the best stuff they would have ever
right.
printed.
Crime,
yeah.
Horror,
right.
Charlie Chan.
Yeah.
And
they picked up a few Fawcett titles, didn't they?
Yeah.
Haunted and.
Yeah,
maybe a Wonder Through the War books. And of course, they had the Westerns. They picked up several Western titles. They had some Rocky Lane stories and things like that.
And they even had some Fox stuff because, like, well, that's where they got
Blue Beetle
from Fox.
Mm-hmm.
But there's also, like, weird Daniel Boone stories and stuff that they. And, like, I think not Avon. I guess it was Fox, like, early Wally Wood, like that Jekyll and Hyde book and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So.
a weird diversity of stuff. Yeah.
Somebody should make a movie about that.
Yeah.
We were promised a trailer, or they're going to throw us out of here. Oh, so yes, you think there's any chance? I would hate to not get your chance to show your trailer. I thought it better.
Thank you.
I will say the stories about the damaged artwork are true. When I was there, and that was 1985, my first trip down to this basement area that apparently at one point used to be like a ballroom or something that people could go hang out after work. But at the time that I was there, this was like a little storage area.
They had weddings between comic books.
Yeah.
They had racks and racks and racks of like old comics and original artwork that was just laying around. And I was a big fan of Avenger Squad, so during the time that I was there, I wanted to bring it back with Amanda Connor, before anyone knew who she was, doing the artwork. I do have the pages to prove it. Basically, I went to see if there was anything left from Avenger Squad, and I found like 5 panels cut out of the original boards in a pile, and I have them somewhere.
Marisi.
Yeah, Pete Maurice.
He might have even worked that way, you know. He might have just done separate panels and pasted them onto a page or something.
I've seen his board say, he did regular stuff. Pete started out his career in the 40s as a comic book artist. The comic book business hit a recession in the early 50s that sent a lot of people going elsewhere to work. And Pete joined the New York City Police Department.
Oh, yeah.
And then he later got back into comics, but he couldn't sign his name because it was cops weren't allowed to moonlight in those days. So that he was PAM, that he used his initials, Pete A. Maurice. And he did a ton of stuff, and he was he was the greatest of the George Tuska imitators.
But he was official.
George Tuska, I don't know if you're familiar with his work.
Teen Titans. Early Teen Titans.
Early Teen Titans, but you know,
Iron Man.
Crime Does Not Pay was
right. Crime Does Not Pay, but George was for a time the like Neil Adams of comics in the 50s. Everybody was looking at George's work and going
for Crime Does Not Pay. Yeah.
Everybody was looking at George's stuff and going, "Wow, that's how you do it." And everybody was imitating him, but Pete actually went to George and said, "Do you mind if I, imitate your style?" And Pete said, "Nah, go right ahead." He didn't care. But a lot of people imitated George Tuska. I worked with him later on, in the early 80s on the Superman newspaper strip.
Mm-hmm.
And, it was a different artist by then. But, it's amazing that the people who passed through,
Well, when I was a kid, I remember seeing Maurice's signature because he would do the M as 3 vertical lines.
Yes.
So I thought he was like an odd Filipino or Asian artist named Pai.
Nope. It was an Italian cop from Staten Island.
Ditko spoke very well. Because he thought I was so cool that he was by day.
Yeah.
Comics at night.
I got to
meet Pete a few times. I was editing Peter Cannon Thunderbolt for DC, which was the character that Pete had created for Charlton in the Action Heroes in the 60s. And I got a call from, I picked up my phone one morning after the first issue had come out, and there was Pete Maurice on the phone, and I thought, uh-oh. But he was very nice. He'd gotten the first issue, and he liked it. He thought we were on the right track and doing a nice job. And he would call occasionally, and we'd talk. And then Dick was having lunch with him at the Society of Illustrators and invited me along. So I got to actually sit down and have lunch with Pete Maurice. And he was telling all these great stories, these cop stories and comics industry stories. And he's the guy. There's a legendary story about an artist who hung Victor Fox out a window.
I've heard this from many different characters.
But
involved.
But Pete was actually the guy who did it. Victor Fox was a little man, and Pete was a big burly, cop type of guy. And he was sick and tired of not getting paid by this thief. So he stormed in and he picked him up and he like leaned him out and I was like, and I've heard this story told. The story that Kaniger did that. To Kaniger.
Heard that,
yeah, but I think that was Kaniger, as he mostly did, appropriating other people's stories as his own. Yeah. Bob, how did you get that scar? Well, that's my dueling scar.
I was assaulted by, I don't even know if I'm in Canada, but I was just in D.C. for like one day, and Kaniger stormed in, you know, because somebody in a fanzine had written, described him as wearing a bow tie, and he defied everyone in the large production room, if you have ever seen me in a bow tie, I will give you $100. Like, I mean, this was outrageous.
That's right.
That somebody didn't drop him out a little ago, but...
I thought he was a lunatic, legally and, you know, every other way. But he was a fascinating man, and he shared an office with Julie Schwartz, who was my editor later on, and a friend. And I knew Bob in the 70s when I worked on staff at DC. Mm-hmm. And I always thought he was fascinating. I mean, he would corner you. He was a close talker. He'd get right in your face and start telling you these stories. And I'm a fanboy. You know, I'm a 20-year-old fanboy in those days, and I loved it. I just, yeah, like, sure. Bob Kaniger is spitting in my face. So I really like the guy, although I made him the victim in my murder.
When you talk about artists, just so we get something in about one artist that I know you'll probably agree, all of you, that was probably one of the best things, if not the best thing in a lot of ways, even despite Ditko and his work, but certainly that DC got from Charlton, that would have to be Jim Aparo, you think?
Yeah.
I mean, doing that Aquaman and later on to Batman stories, he was just really a talent. He was one of the few guys over at DC back then, I don't know, you know, how Stan felt, but that I would have wanted to really, you know, go after, you know, and so forth, and get him at Marvel if we could have done it.
Yeah, I always thought Aparo's Batman, you know, I mean, I think his is the fit. Love you, Neil. But you know, Aparo for me is the definitive Batman. That Haney.
The Phantoms he did at Charlton. Just,
mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
I just have to say
Phantoms of Charlton.
The Spectre.
Yes.
With Michael Fleischer writing.
That was very
absolutely phenomenal.
Phantom Stranger.
Yeah.
And another great artist in a very similar vein was Don Newton. Uh-huh. Who, you know, Don started in the 70s at Charlton. Lush. He did The Phantom. God, that was
Baron Werewolf.
Baron Werewolf. Whatever he did. Whatever he did was gorgeous. Yeah. Then he went to D.C. and he started doing... Captain Marvel, which was his dream job, although I don't think those were his dream scripts for the character. But...
His
Batman was awesome. I got to work with him on a bunch of times. You know, he drew my stories. He did an issue with DC Presents. It was Superman and Green Arrow, and it was a pretty poor script. It was like there was a whole lot of nothing to it, and then you know the you see Don Newton drawing, and it's like, well, it's not so bad. You know, it was a case of great art saving a bad script. But
and another artist who wasn't really too appreciated in his lifetime from Charlton's Pat Boyette, who's gotten a lot of respect ever since. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
You know, and again, that was someone I worked a lot with in the 80s, and a larger than life character.
Yeah.
You know, he was a filmmaker, radio announcer, and
TV personality.
Yeah. Well, DC and Marvel wouldn't have allowed these guys to have as individual styles in some cases. You know, Marvel would have had Stan would have wanted them to have more action, and DC would have had its own version.
Stan would have had Jack lay out a few issues for Boyette to pencil over.
Sure.
But Pat never did anything for Marvel. Ever.
Pat Boyette. I don't think so. Nor did Aparo. No.
He did a few. Boyette did a few jobs for DC. He did some Blackhawks.
Yeah.
He may have done some mystery stories.
I don't think he ever did anything for Marvel.
Yeah, but I don't think he ever did anything for Marvel.
Yeah.
Yeah. But he was a very. I love his stuff. Yeah. But he was a.
Well, you have different viewpoints. I remember when Stan told me once. He said, "There's one artist at DC I'd really like to get over here. Who's that? It's Joe Kubert." I said, "Well, that's great. Joe Kubert, my favorite." But he says, "I want somebody else to ink him." But if you have to have it explained to you, we'll go on to something else. I practically fell on the floor.
Well, Joe
that
did
one.
Do some Atlas stuff.
Yeah.
I went through. Yeah. You know, I was doing.
Yeah, but it was the idea of Stan wanting somebody else to ink him.
Yeah.
I couldn't. That was right up there with Jack putting out an issue of X-Men for Alex Toth to pencil and Vinnie Coletta to ink. I mean, there are certain combinations that shouldn't
like
be there.
They
should.
Yeah.
Wow.
So. Yeah. On that note,
Vinny was a Charlton artist.
Yeah.
Vinny was absolutely a Charlton artist.
So
Vinny was Vinny's studio you know, kept the romance line going.
Yeah.
I mean, and Vinny drew the best. Vinny drew beautiful.
He did.
Vinny,
and I guess Joe Sinnott was ghosting a lot of that stuff.
Joe, yes. Yeah.
Vinny had more talent than he wanted to admit, you know.
Yes, he did. I'm one of these guys who when people start jumping on Vinny, I will defend him. You know, he became the pariah that they made him. Because it's like, Vinny, we need this job overnight. Can you do it? Sure. It's going to stink, but I can do it. We don't care. We need it overnight. Because it costs money. If you miss shipping, it could cost 10, 15 grand to reschedule the time. So Vinny would ink it overnight. It would suck, but it would make printing. And then he'd go to them and say, how about some more work? And they go, well, you know, that last job you did for me wasn't very good.
Well, when you look at some of his late 50s Charlton romance is very stylistic.
Very.
He did some real nice, you know, like negative space type
stuff. Yeah, yeah, and some really
nice
interesting stuff.
Well, he had a whole studio working on some of those Charlton romance,
yes.
I think, because Dick Giordano told me once about how somehow they were all working in some room to get some, you know, some rush jobs over, and he had to go off to a cot to get some... a little sleep so they get back to work, and he woke up with some naked woman on top of him and Vinny taking pictures.
I've heard that story.
Vinny, by the way,
Vinny got all that work.
Vinny, by the way, always had naked women with him.
Yeah.
Nobody knows. I worked down the hall from him at he was art director at DC, and I was again 20 years old and sitting in a cubicle in the hallway, and every day Vinny's bookie would come in, every afternoon Vinny's hookers would come in, you know, it would be like he'd close the door, he'd do his business, and you know, and they'd leave and he'd ink.
Just died a little too early for the Sopranos.
Yes. Well, he had a house out of the Sopranos in Jersey, you know.
I hear.
Yeah, with the pool, with the pillars and the whole bit.
Were you there?
I've seen pictures.
I know that Gary Friedrich and John Verporten went once, and I guess John wanted to take a picture of Gary, you know, by Vinny's big pool.
Yeah.
And he starts taking it, and Vinny comes running out of the house. No pictures, no pictures. He didn't want anybody to know how he lived, you know, because he didn't get that on an anchor's salary.
Or from that fried chicken restaurant, but that's a whole other story. Anyway, I think, Vinny owned a fried chicken restaurant on 10th Avenue in New York.
Coletta's Fried Chicken.
The 11th?
No,
I didn't know that.
No, he was like, you brought a bunch of us in, and it's like, yeah, have some chicken, you guys. And it's like,
Vinny. Is it really chicken?
Yeah. We finally figured it was like, you know, laundering money or something. He was laundering money for somebody through this place.
He was my friend after I became editor-in-chief.
Oh, I'll bet he was. all right. I think what we shall do now is have the world premiere of the Charlton documentary trailer, after which we will open things up to questions.
How we can, you know, our fundraiser.
Will
you want to do it after the fact?
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, not eBay, but like YouTube and...
We also need you to move
You want to keep this off for the documentary, but that's good.
Right. Although I am making an audio that we may put up on the Charlton website.
Yeah, good.
Okay. Here we go.
Lights.
Ready?
Oh.
Lights. I think it's the bottom one. The second to bottom one? The third to bottom
The third from bottom?
It's Charlton Gang.
Charlton was absolutely essential. If I hadn't gone up to see Charlton, then none of the rest would have happened the way it did.
They gave me work when I didn't have it.
That's where it all began, in Charlton.
Charlton was a stepping stone.
You want me to get into the whole thing about how I heard Charlton was a front for the mob?
Management there was, I think, questionable at times at best.
Ooh, they were no good, they were mean.
I think this was a matter of, you know, right hand not talking to the left hand.
These two gentlemen met in jail.
They put together this company called Charlton because both of them had a son named Charles.
And then when they got out, they started publishing.
At one point, they actually did have to move the comics operation into a bowling alley.
Suddenly you hear a strike and somebody going, yeah! You
know? Charlton was a sidewater of a sidewater, and they were out there doing their thing, and nobody was paying any attention.
Charlton was just a hodgepodge of weird titles.
It was the three-legged dog of comics.
Guys were free to do really whatever they wanted within the boundaries of, you know, good taste in the comics code.
C-A-T-A-P. Yes, cheap. They were cheap.
Hell yes, they're cheap.
What they needed was carbon-based life forms who knew how to type.
I don't know how much I should be saying about this.
Charlton was selling some of their characters to multiple people. That's kind of funny.
Well, I'd be willing to confess to a felony on camera.
We did too.
Sure.
The printing press that they had was used to print cereal boxes, which is a whole different process altogether.
Printing was horrible.
At Charlton, we were getting $4 a page.
Would you believe I was getting $8 a page?
But there was a little bit of less quality, I'd say, when you get that Charlton book.
Paper was much lower quality than anybody else was using.
You could smell them beginning to decay even as they were rolling off the presses.
They decided to shred tons of archival comic book pages.
Somebody just throwing out these original pages because they couldn't possibly conceive of them being valuable.
The cover might not be as slick or glossy as the Marvel or the DC one.
Or you'd pick up a comic book and the wrong insides would be in the cover.
Beautiful artwork. They laid on the floor so the guy painting the seal didn't drip paint on the floor.
And if it was a bad snowy day, they would throw them down on the floor so it would absorb all the slush.
It's something out of a sitcom, which I suppose is why you're making this documentary.
Charlton has its place and deserves to be remembered.
There was a creative, powerful force that lived at Charlton Comics, and it was producing top quality work.
I loved working for Charlton. I could have used more money.
There wouldn't be a Watchmen if it wasn't for the Charlton characters.
I think Charlton should be proud of the stuff they put out.
It showed in the work. I mean, some people were busting their butts, and that was amazing, amazing stuff.
I'm perfectly willing to say sometimes you really do win the lottery, and I did.
Next month, this will be finished.
This will be done, that's all. So any questions?
Well, that's just what we did was we self-invested. We put our own money and time into rounding up just about, a quarter of the amount of people we have to talk to for this movie to cut this trailer with. And we went for some home runs right away. We went for the recognizable people, some of which are here, and hope to get Mr. Thomas soon and Mort added to this this movie. So the idea was to get as powerful a punch as we could up front and tell some of the more humorous anecdotes to kind of grab attention to go and put forward a fundraising campaign. So we have the website, charltonmovie.com. Y'all have postcards. We really kind of need help with this because these guys are doing a great job trying to bring back the spirit of Charlton, and we're trying to make this movie to kind of dovetail into it and help promote the whole thing as one giant resurgence. But cracking through the pop culture sphere into this Marvel and DC owned pop culture ecosphere is tough. It's difficult. So we kind of need to recruit some soldiers, some ground soldiers to get people interested because there's some great stuff here. People need to see it. And
you wouldn't believe the other dirt that we've dug up.
Oh, okay. That was.
This is just
a story in here.
This is just the source. Every time I find more dirt on these people, I do a Google search on that and I find 10 more things.
And there's even a couple of things you can't even use, isn't there?
Oh, there's yeah.
Yeah, there's some great stories. But you know, just like Roy was saying earlier about the story with the naked women with Dick Giordano, we were told that same story by one of the guys in the trailer, so we don't want to use it, but you know, and it's a difficult,
yeah,
right, yeah. Well, would you like to star in it more?
No, as the naked woman.
It's the other part of this. It's very nebulous, as TC can attest to. We've talked to TC a lot about this. It's hard to really figure out what's the total truth here. You know, we hear the same story from four different people, but it's not quite the same story. And a lot of these people have also passed away. So it's tough. We're trying to do the best we can with a company that went out of business 30 years ago. But I think, as I go back to the beginning of the panel, I sat in the same panel last year and went, oh my God, this is awesome. This is just awesome. And people need to hear this. So, Jackie, you want to talk a little bit about the fundraising campaign? And
so last year after the panel was over, one of the first people we talked to was Denny O'Neill, and we, of course, thanked him for a great panel, and we saw he had a brochure for something called the Hero Initiative, which some of you may know is a foundation to stop comic book artists who develop these amazing characters.
$1 billion properties.
I mean, characters that you know and love, but these creators don't have the rights to them. They die penniless because of their medical bills. So the Hero Initiative tries to help stop that. Thanks for your sign. What, great.
5 minutes? Is that what it is? Okay.
We'll wrap it up. So we wanted to give back. We didn't want to give just $50. We wanted to give more. So hopefully, maybe in a couple months, we're going to launch a fundraising campaign to recoup the costs we've already done, get a little bit more, send us on the road, get the rest of the interviews, sell the movie, and have a little bit or a huge chunk, depends on how much you guys give us and how much we sell it for, and we can give back to the Hero Initiative and help everybody all around. And thank you to whoever recognized Joe Sinnott in a movie. He is a great guy.
Yeah, Joe's fun.
He still inks Spider-Man every week for the Sunday paper.
So that trailer, we're going to do a second version and we're going to label who the people are. We figured you guys know who they are. I did have the titles, but I took them out. And we'll post it Monday on charltonmovie.com, so you can push it out there. We have a YouTube channel, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram. Yep. We're going to have a Pinterest. We're streaming live right now out on Periscope. So we're trying. Yeah. It's tough. It's tough to get through to that younger generation who knows the Marvel Cinematic Universe and Gotham. But we'll try. We'll try.
Yeah, and if anyone wants to learn more about what we're doing with the new books, you know, you can just Google Charlton Neo.
Right.
Also, we have the direct site is morttodd.com, which I humbly named after myself so that no one would steal it.
You know, I just made that connection just now.
So mortod.com, and you'll see all the Charlton covers. You click on them, you learn more about them and how to get it.
And there's also a recently severely undersupplied website, charltonneo.blogspot.com, that also has our submissions guidelines on it somewhere, and and other news.
We have a Facebook page, Charlton Arrow. But like I said, you Google Charlton Neo, N-E-O, and you'll see it all pop up.
I think what's cool here is, like, you guys have a chance to be, like, you know, the people who want to be the first one to know something new or something. Ooh, I was there at the very beginning. I knew about this before you. You can talk about the Charlton Neo stuff and the movie and all the stuff in next year when...
It's before we sell out.
Before we're awesome. Before there's an E-Man motion picture.
And by the way, if there are any offers for us to sell out, please come see us. I think it was Jerry Rubens who said, I'm not selling out, I'm opting in.
Whatever you do, do not steal this comic book.
And we have time for one or two quick questions. Anybody have anything? Yeah, or
I think he was called the Black Crow, I can't remember. But,
yeah.
And they did like a Midnight, Professor Coffin's Midnight Tales, and a war book. So they were trying, you know, one of everything.
Zoo Funnies was back.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That had Nyoka the Jungle Girl in it for several years.
Well, this is when they were doing the funny animals.
I think in the course of their 40 years, they published something like a little over 6,000 individual issues.
Oh, John Buscema drew a comic. Remember that comic John Buscema did in
Nature
the 50s?
Boy.
Nature Boy.
Yeah.
He wrote about on the wind that it made Nature Boy.
Oh, yeah, and they had like Jerry Siegel did Mr. Muscles.
Mr. Muscles,
I got a submission from, I believe it was Jerry Siegel. It was written longhand and said it was Jerry Siegel for a character that he was interested in submitting when I was there.
Wow.
Yeah, well, if this was the mid-80s, he'd sent stuff to Ace as well.
Yeah. So,
Just about everybody had a little something to do there.
Yeah. Jerry Schuster was drawing crime comics.
Joe Schuster
was drawing crime, weird horror crime stuff in the 50s there. Just looked nothing like that.
They had those hot titles Frank Merriwell at Yale, you know.
Yeah.
No. The building is gone. I hear there's. We were there. There's like a, you know, a Home Depot or something there.
Where it, you're being interviewed on there was behind. Was the place.
Yeah, we went to Derby to do that.
Yeah, it's been like it's got like a Quiznos. It's got a Planet Fitness, but it's just a big strip mall basically.
Yeah. Yes.
Quick question. You said that DC acquired a lot of like action heroes. Does Charlton Neo now? Did you guys acquire?
Yeah, well, no. Because those are all the existing, in fact, even the action heroes might be contested as being public domain. And I think that's why DC's gone out of their way to give them extremely new costumes and outfits and just keep the name. But so they're all the other characters public domain.
Yeah, the good ones are taken. There's some public domain characters you can play with, and even those are kind of hazy because, like, you know, Charlton was not exactly, you know, keeping track of who they sold
they
stuff to.
They weren't recopyrighted.
Right. Yeah.
There's
right.
going to be a whole section.
So,
that
but
we've been
focusing on creating new material in the spirit of.
Yeah. But we do have like Cynthia Doyle, Nurse and Love, a longtime comic, and there's even a paperback book and all this.
And Spook Man.
We turned her into a vampire hunter.
And we've got not
set in the '60s. Who's two nurses from the comics back then, Betsy Crane and. Doyle and they fight vampires now in post-apocalyptic 1960s.
And we have Spook Man is back by Roger McKenzie and Sandy Carruthers.
That was a Pat Boyette.
Yeah, Pat Boyette created character. But you know, again, we're trying to focus on creating new stuff that you know is kind of in the spirit of we're not doing ongoing stories. We do anthologies. We do
we're doing Funny Animal. We're doing teen humor.
Paul's
romance.
Well, because that is Paul Kupperberg's secret romances.
Yeah,
Twilight Zone freaking endings. Anyway, that, unfortunately, we'll have to wrap this up. Thank you all for being here. Thank you, Roy, for coming on, and TC, and Mort, and everybody. And, thanks for being here. And, again, check out the Charlton movie. We really want to make this thing happen. Thanks.
Great.
Have fun.